After a long way from home, can't sleep at night. Grab your telephone, something just ain't right. That's evil. Evil is going on wrong. I am warning you, brother. You better watch your happy home.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie discussion in the multiverse. I am your host, Adam Porters, and joining me today, the only silver bullet he's taken is the one to the dome at the Colorado Rockies, Sweet Sean Zakovacs from the internet.
Werewolf bar mitzvah, spooky, scary, boys becoming men, men becoming wolves.
Very scary, and of course, the only thing that... that he's interested in is, does the Wolfman have nards? Bruce Leslie.
I'm a prickly pear, and it's super scary season, because the season is super scary.
Oh, man. If you haven't pulled over to the side of the road to change your pants here and everything, welcome back to the super scary season here at HMP. Oh, I got it this week, only because I wrote it down.
Nice.
But we are back every now. We told everybody last week that we would be reviewing Puppet Master this week, but we saw the play on the field and decided we need to call an audible on this bad boy here. So instead, we're going to be reviewing Marvel's special presentation on Disney Plus entitled Werewolf by Night. Don't worry, Puppet Master's still coming on the way, and we got some other fun stuff in store for you fine people. Before we do all that, we do want to say a giant thank you to the people that support us over at patreon.com/HMP. Those awesome people get pre-show, post-show, Dinger Zone, and of course, Dinger Zone. We're talking all about scary movies, and what was the other couple of things? And cider. Scary movies and cider.
Food. Yeah.
The stuff people love to talk about. So if you want to get all that, help this show as well. Patreon.com/HMP and be like our new supporter, Mark T, who's joined us at the £4 level, which I don't know. Again, I'm not a monetary guy. I'm going to say that's $40,000. Is that probably close?
Yep. Correct.
Yep. Okay. Mark, I don't know how you do it, but God bless you. It's a great thing here. And as such, Sweet Shanti's got to give you a nickname.
Okay, Mark T. Mark, bring a backpack because we're going on a journey. Ooh. By the way, this is a prepared statement. This is it off the top of the dome. We're going on a journey. So as you may already know, you have an ancient Kentish surname that starts showing up in English documents around the 15th century. Legal stuff, really. This person married that person. One of your descendants thought it was important enough to let everyone know that he owned a donkey, that he got the law involved, you know, that sort of thing. Then around the mid-1800s, some of your family moved to New Zealand, where they're described as fishermen, sealers, and whalers. And I have to be honest with you here, Mark. I'd never heard the term or work sealer before, but I've chosen to believe that a sealer is a person who sets up single seals on blind dates, because the other option here is... It involves Captain Cavemanning Andre from the movie Andre, and... I'd rather think about your ancestors setting up meat cutes for sea dogs. Anyway, Mark T, I'm not sure if you're a New Zealand guy or an England guy, but now you're definitely an HMP guy, and everyone at HMP needs a nickname. And your new nickname is the Whaler because of the jobs of your forefathers, and also because I'm originally from Hartford, Connecticut, and we used to have a hockey team there called the Whalers, which was the greatest bad professional hockey team in America. Yes, brass bonanza indeed. It used to be on my cell phone every single time somebody called me. So congratulations, Mark. You're the newest member of HMP. And thank you.
Secretly, I'm going to call you Hurricane, just on account.
So who moved to Carolina first? Shaughnessy or the Canes?
Shaughnessy.
Yeah.
So they followed you.
I would like to think that was the reason, but it's not.
I think tax purposes is probably a lot of that.
They could have just kept the name the Carolina Whalers. That would have been kind of weird. I'd have liked it.
Yeah, right.
Whale tail logo, by the way, is the only logo in any professional sport that I would be willing to get tattooed on me.
Well, also, don't forget, you got the whale. You know, you got the whale tail. You got the W. And then in between the whale tail and the W is the H for Hartford. And the blank space in between. Yeah, it's a really great logo.
That is the only professional sports logo I would consider getting tattooed. No lie. No joke. No
this has cap. Been your 1980s right. hockey logo minute.
Also, don't forget about Pucky the Whale.
Of course. If you so yeah. The Whaler, Mark, you got it right there for you, buddy. And if you'd like to be like Mark, hit us up at patreon.com/HMP. Get your own HMP nickname here. And hey, if you can't join over at the Patreon, get yourself some Dirty Babies merch, man. It's out there. We got stickers. We got hats and shirts and throw pillows, you name it. There's a little Dirty Baby out there with your name on it. So why don't you go pick that up there, put a little Dirty Baby in your house, and you know, get back to that primal Dirty Baby that we all used to be, you know?
Watch some Trans or Z and drink coffee out of your Dirty Baby mug.
Little tiny yes, sippy perfect. Cup. It's absolutely terrible. So head on over. The links will be in the show notes for that. Oh, look at this.
Bales here.
We have a letter from Dan. Dan writes in. Hey, guys, I've been listening to your show for years. Every week I tune in to listen. Even so, during the birth of my children, I had your podcast on the drive to the hospital.
Wow.
Whenever I have you on now, my partner reacts with flashbacks to the births.
I'm sorry.
Do what it do.
I'm okay, sorry.
Triplets and named them. That's right. Adam, Bruce, and Sean, and the kicker is they're girls.
They're all girls. That would be amazing. Okay, when I will be in a position to sign up for Patreon in a month or so to start contributing to this amazing show. When I do, please put Dead Man's Shoes on the Patreon vote list, and I will vote 1,000 times. Keep up the amazing work. You guys bring such amazing shows each week in and out. Even when it's the dullest of movies, each of you has a way of capturing the audience and sucking us into the story. All the best. That's Dan from Swindon, UK.
Thanks, Dan. Dan,
that means a lot to me.
Dan.
Dan, we really appreciate it. And again, the fact that that you heard our stuff on the way to one of the most important moments in your entire life says something crazy about you and something pretty awesome about us. Patreon.com/HMP. And of course, if you want to be like Dan, drop us an email at hearmoviepodcast@gmail.com. Close up the mailbag.
Bales here.
All right, boys and girls, here it is. Let's get into it. Here's the trailer for Werewolf by Night.
This Halloween, you can't escape the shock, the terror of Werewolf by Night.
Tonight, it is every hunter for themselves.
Good luck. I'll be rotting for you.
But one of you is a monster. Masquerading as one of our own. I can't wait to find out what breed of evil you are. You'll wanna see this, darling.
Please don't do this. Death is coming for you!
Alrighty, that was the trailer for Werewolf by Night. You know what time it is. Oh, I can only imagine where this goes. Bruce, what do you got?
In 2001, the writing duo of Dan Abnett and Andy Planning, along with artist Michael Lopez, brought a new face to the world of Marvel horror comics. You could say it was a new type of character for a new millennium, and her name was Elsa. Elsa Bloodstone, and she's super scary because she has blood in her name. Now, Elsa is a legacy character of sorts, as she is the daughter of Ulysses Bloodstone, a Marvel monster hunter who'd been around since the 1970s. I don't know for certain what the inspiration for the young, cute female monster hunter was, but Buffy the Vampire Slayer was in its fourth season in 2001 and a certified hit for the young folks. Hey, Sean, back in 2001, we were the young folks. Did you like Buffy? I'll take that as a yes. So Abnett and Planning both swore that they had never seen an episode of Buffy when they created Elsa. But come on, Buffy was in the zeitgeist whether you'd seen an episode of her show or not.
Yeah.
Anyway, much like Buffy, Elsa also slays. Elsa's first appearance was in her own miniseries, simply named Bloodstone, which detailed her origin. Her origin was pretty simple, really. She was born, then followed in her father's footsteps. In 2018, a development happened in the comics that may be relevant to MCU and Disney Plus fans in the future. HMP's most maligned sidekick, Wong, assembled a new version of the Midnight Suns, including Elsa Bloodstone, in addition to Blade, Dr. Voodoo, Ghost Rider, Iron Fist, and Man-Thing. Some of those characters seem to be gaining prominence either now or in the near future, and it makes me wonder if a Midnight Suns movie or streaming TV show is in the works. Given her distinct Bloodstone lineage, Elsa has a few things going for that the average person does not. Superhuman strength, speed, durability, and endurance, and of course a regenerative healing factor, those things are just icing on the cake, because her true superpower is an immunity to vampires, which I'd say makes her a perfect candidate for a vampire slayer. But that would be a ripoff, or maybe just parallel thinking. Anyway, speaking of parallel thinking, Adam, do you have a list?
No, Adam.
No, wait. Elsa Bloodstone also showed up in the third issue of the Marvel Zombies versus the Army of Darkness to save Ash from a zombified power pack. How's that for a crossover?
Shoot.
Okay. Back to you, Adam. Adamantium. That's what I'm going to start calling you.
Oh, well, thank you. If that wasn't enough, let me sell everybody on this Marvel special, because this sucker has everything. We got that awesome 70s, 80s Marvel special presentation logo. They better keep that, by the way. Mm-hmm. We got Marvel, spooky Marvel intro. This special is in black and white, aged to look like film. Very nice. We got taxonomy, manly men in makeup. You get to play a game of Gozer or David Bowie. That's fun. An animatronic corpse that sends you on a monster hunt to be the rightful leader of the new Monster Hunters? I don't know, sure. Fire tuba, Victrola action, jump scare music stings, axe swinging, head bashing, Judy throwing, that's akin to Judy chopping. mini crossbow, hand shooter thing, hand chopping, tomb busting, lady sniffing, ear ripping, body slamming, a scene I call the garage fight, cigarette burns and digital film, man thing, and the scariest creature of them all, BB Glazer. This show's got everything.
Oh, man. That is great. So first off, I want to say that I watched zero trailers. Mm-hmm. I knew almost jack squat going into this. The one thing I did know going into it is I think, Sean, you had told me that it had like this awesome, awesome, nostalgic, old school special presentation.
Right.
Thing. Like, and that's not a spoiler. I mean, that was just something to look forward to. So when I saw that, I absolutely loved it. You did not oversell it. You
sold it. Good. Very good. So,
that's always a risk. You build something up, hype it up too much. But knowing nothing about this, I had some incredible surprise and enjoyment. And I even thought for a moment that maybe we weren't even going to actually get a werewolf in this. Like, did the trailers actually show the werewolf?
Yes, they do.
It did feel a little Jeff Goldblum-y, just going like, you aren't going to have any werewolves in your werewolf movie, are you?
But I was starting to think, you know, this would be kind of a trick, because this really felt like an Elsa Bloodstone story and a Man-Thing story. And to be honest, Werewolf by Night, cool. I think it's no surprise to anybody that I like Werewolf by Night. But the introduction of the Man-Thing officially into the MCU is a big, to quote Joe Biden, it's a big bleeping deal.
Yeah.
I got to say.
Than Werewolf by Night.
I got to say, this show pulled off a miracle, because I hate Man-Thing. I hate that character so much. And for him to be my favorite thing on this show, I'm only calling him Ted from this point forward, by the way. He'll always be Ted now. And maybe I saw this at just the exact right time, But like this whole thing here, this little hour long thing, not even an hour, it was so, it's so wonderful. It feels special. It feels like this is the first thing I have seen from Marvel where start to finish, Marvel TV, where from start to finish, it's just perfect in the thing that it is.
Yeah.
It is a delight, this thing. It is. I cannot sing its praises enough.
I love this show. I love this special presentation. But if they had made it 100 minutes and put it on the big screen, I don't know how it would have felt. That's the weird thing.
Yes.
Like the venue is suddenly becoming such a big part of my judgment, because I was sitting there watching it thinking, like, I'm glad they didn't make it for the theater. I'm glad they didn't make it theatrical, because first off, I don't think they would have had, like, they would have said, okay, we looked at the actuary has the numbers back. Black and white movies make 85% less than color movies. So we got to make this color. This can't be black and white. If it's
that's literally what they told Rob Zombie for this Munsters thing that he put on Netflix and everything. They literally told him, you cannot do this in black and white.
And it needed to be in black and white if you've seen the trailer. But anyway, it would have looked good in black and white.
Spoiler alert, I actually wasn't good, but it wasn't as bad as you would think. We'll talk about that in an after show.
I'm just talking about what it looks like. I don't know anything about the story. I haven't seen it. I've just seen, the trailer. But anyway, they never would have been able to make it black and white. I think they would have said, you need more werewolf. Like, I was really thinking this will be the coolest thing ever if they trick us into watching an Elsa Bloodstone and Man-Thing story under the guise of Werewolf by Night. Like, if he didn't transform on screen, I know a lot of people would have hated it, but I would have kind of like chuckled and loved it.
Yeah, but that's also so in your path. I mean, that is you are fixing for that. Like you want that so bad where eventually, because somebody is going to pull that off eventually. It's just not going to be Marvel. And the thing about the show is that it's so sure-handed. They knew exactly what they were doing with this thing. They, every beat, because if you get something wrong, if you get the temperature wrong for this show, it's not nearly as good. But the way they're playing it, that sort of Bride of Frankenstein feel, because that's what it is. They're really going for Bride of Frankenstein.
Well, here's what I love is it's obviously an homage to Universal movie monsters. I mean, the Wolfman was a Universal movie monster, but because Universal Pictures is still a company that makes movies and distributes movies and is still technically in competition with Disney, the creators are like, oh yes, this was a love letter to Hammer horror films. And like Hammer horror films were in color, the ones that I've watched.
Yeah.
There's a couple of early ones that are in black and white, to be sure.
Yeah, Hammer made a lot of films before they made horror films.
But they were like, that was what kind of made those horror movies great, is that they were in color and it was just so, like, the red is so vibrant and the blood and stuff like that. They played on all of that.
Yeah, so, it's just funny how far they're trying to find a way to say we love Universal movie monsters without
any legal implications. That's how much we love them.
Particularly considering what a horrible failure to launch the dark shared universe is.
So let's talk about this for a half second. Speaking of like all that and Wolfman and stuff, what do you guys think of the Wolfman design in this? Because we've seen so many over the years. What are your thoughts on this one?
Can I slow us down just a minute before we talk about the design?
Okay.
I do want to ask, what do you feel about the amount of Wolfman that we get?
You got to go Jaws style, and like the more that you see of it, the less it's going to be, and you want that, because here's the thing, when the werewolf finally shows up in this, you're stoked for it.
So Jaws style, I think Aliens falls into Jaws style a little, or Alien, not Aliens.
Right.
So, but the thing is, you got to have a tease, and then a reveal. But we don't really get, like, maybe there should have been some hints that there was. And then finally it starts to become obvious or something. I don't, that's kind of cliche for werewolf stories, but, usually what happens is one person is convinced that they are the werewolf and it turns out somebody else is, it's that kind of thing. But it would have been nice, I think, to have had a little bit of a tease before we got the reveal.
I think it's basically perfect the way it is. I love that it's sort of like Bloodsport. I think that's great. I thought I was going to hate The Maze.
It's sort of like Bloodsport. You might be the only critic who's going to compare Werewolf by Night to the Jean-Claude Van Damme classic.
Well, there is a touch of Bloodsport in this thing, which I love. You're
not wrong. I never in a million years would have been the one to come up with that idea.
When Man-Thing starts chanting Kumite, Kumite, it's one of the best parts of the show.
But no, Sean, I never in a million years would have come up with that on my own. But now that you say it, I totally get what you mean.
You know, I think they're having the other characters be so loud and so over the top means that the Wolfman himself can underplay his role, which he kind of has to. And it's everything about this thing is just so pitch perfect, which is weird when you realize who the director of this thing is.
Yeah, so that was my next one of my next big points.
is this Giacchino? How do you pronounce his name?
Michael Giacchino's directorial debut.
Okay, that was my question. Is if the I know he's a composer, right?
Yeah, like, yeah. I call him like the John Williams heir apparent because he's kind of become that these days. Just
on this show, I've called him the Burger King of composers.
Yeah, the guy that people keep on going to.
It's amazing to me that he got a shot, and it was a shot that was this high profile. Like, I just think it's a cool thing. I never would have guessed. It'd be like, oh, wow, you're actually, I don't even know, like how does that job interview go down? They're like, have you ever directed before?
No, I'm Michael Giacchino.
He just goes, look at the last 25 years worth of music that I put out. Do you think how to time things well enough? I think I can orchestrate things a little well.
That darn secretary, she filed your application wrong. It's supposed to say music director, right?
Hey, I was so glad because I was like, there's no way he didn't do the music for this as well. And he did.
That's how he got the gig, man.
How could you
said, I'll do the music for free if you let me direct.
Now, did his brother work on the script though? Like, I feel like there's like, he had a brother or a that worked on this too.
That I don't know.
I don't know the answer to that.
I'll have to look that one up real quickly. You guys talk amongst yourselves. Oh, let's talk about the Wolfman design now.
Yes, please, because that's literally where I wanted to go. Because one of the things that I really like about the design of this Wolfman is I don't care what they say. Yeah, Hammer Films. Okay. This is the Universal Wolfman. I mean, there's no getting around
with
it,
a little bit of like half transformation in American Werewolf in London. A little halfway,
but I'm just talking about the suit itself. It looks so much like the Universal Werewolf, which is great. It's perfect. It's what it should be. And I like that because it's so ham-fisted, the whole thing, that when the transformation happens and you have like people putting their hand up to their mouths, you know, as it's happening.
And also, by the way, Michael Giacchino, is that the proper way to say that?
Giacchino.
I don't know why I want to say Giacchino. Anyway, not only did he not have a brother that worked on the show, he may not even have a brother. What happened is I read the director and the composer, and I was like thinking, oh, those guys must be brothers. They have the same first name, so they can't.
They're a little closer than brothers.
They're conjoined twins.
So, you know, the it's the thing where, like, I'm 5 minutes into watching this thing, and I'm like, this thing is it's running pretty perfect so far. Like, this is, they're gonna drop the ball because, you know, it's a Marvel TV show. Like, at some point they screw it up, but it never happens.
And I want to just chime in and say I love the werewolf design because they clearly went Wolfman. You know, they clearly went classic Lon Chaney Jr. Wolfman.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Of course they did it with modern technique so that it looks real. Like, it's a really cool way to do the classic Universal interpretation of Wolfman, a little bit better than when they tried to do it with Benicio del Toro.
You got synthetic hair instead of like actual bison, so you don't smell. Sounds like you don't care enough about your craft.
But, well, anyway, I, I really like the choice that they made. Plus, it's a choice that kind of felt a little like Teen Wolf to me, which I'm not going to lie is a plus.
Yeah, me too.
It's a form that will blend in with other superheroes if they ever do the point where, like, yeah, we're going to have Werewolf by Night fighting alongside Falcon and Winter Soldier at some point. I can see it with that design. If they were a little more comic book accurate, it would have came out looking a bit more like Underworld or something. And that's just been done plenty. And I don't know that anybody's ever done a really good revisit to Lon Chaney Jr. So I like the choice they made.
If that Wolfman dances on top of a UPS truck, I will have the best time of my life.
Oh, boy.
I wouldn't see him dunk a basketball personally.
Hey, listen, you know, that's why you got the third act, eh?
I love it. So, Bruce, you've spoken a lot about Elsa Bloodstone so far.
Yeah.
The other characters, are these just, this might be an unfair question, are they cut out of whole cloth or is it something from source material?
I think if I were going to give you my opinion, which, you know, you positives you can say with definity, right? Like you can say, oh, that is definitely a character from this comic.
Yeah.
But when you say that they're not from any comic, then it just might mean you never ran across them or you're not aware of them. So I'm just going to say I'm not aware of any of them being from comics other than, you know, obviously Ted.
You realize you're not on the stand right now.
I know, but it's still, okay. I just kind of, you know, one time I talked about how they don't have any leopards in India, and I'm trying not to.
Oh, my Lord. Oh, my God. The Indian community came after Bruce so hard.
I had no idea that we had, that we literally had over 100 Indian listeners. I had no idea. And we had to have over 100 because I got 100 complaints.
They caught us on YouTube, and the Indians were just like, you whiteys don't know what you're talking about. We were like, that's fair. That's totally fair.
Fair.
But I do like how it was mostly pretty much Bruce that they were all.
I just went on there and I said, "Oh, I meant Jaguars," and then they were cool with that. That's all I had to say.
Like, all right, well, now that you've straightened it all out, we're good.
Yeah.
I really hope to get back to my question to you, Bruce. I'm really hoping that some of them are from source material because there's looking through the IMDb cast list here. David Silverman plays the role of the Flaming Tuba. And I would really like to think that the Flaming Tuba is something that is from Marvel.
Oh, man, I wish the Flaming Tuba was from Marvel because when me and Silas were watching this together, we couldn't help it. We did laugh out loud at the Flaming Tuba. We were like, now that is a choice. That's all I'm going to say is that is a choice. What is the super scariest musical instrument? Duh, the Flaming Tuba.
Well, here's the thing too, though. Like, it's a like if you saw somebody with a black tuba, I don't know why it's black, but it's scary because it's black and it's on fire. I'm going away from that. I don't care. Like, I'm not normally wouldn't be scared of a tuba.
And but, the guy you're talking about, David Silverman. I mean, I don't know much about him, but reading, you know, like his bio, it looks like he's like a longtime Simpsons guy, not even an actor.
Yeah.
Like, it's weird. Yeah, we got a Simpsons animator just to come on here. And play. Like, that is just a left turn. Like the guy who was supposed to do it called in sick and just so happens that, like, Giacchino is friends with this guy. So he's like, you're on my way to work. Can I just pick
Michael
you up?
Giacchino.
Yeah, Giacchino. Or Giacchino. What was the name of that guy from, like, season one? Justin Julie. What was his last name? Justin Guarini. That's what I'm thinking.
Oh, my word. Wow. First... There's so many. What? There's so much to unpack with that statement that you just made.
Season one of what?
American Idol. This kid pulled season one American Idol reference out of his back pocket. Wow.
You know, Dunkerman or whatever his name was.
Brian
still Dunkerman. Haven't watched the second of it.
You're not missing.
It's not too late, man. You can get it on Peacock Plus.
Season 23 is out now.
Go back and watch season one, so you know what I'm talking about.
Mm. Yeah, you can't jump onto American Idol in season 28.
You'll be lost.
You won't get it. You can be like, who is that, this?
That's my biggest fear.
Who is this Simon character, and why is he so angry all the time?
Boy, he's salty.
Anyways, Man Thing. I was shocked at first. I wasn't sure it was Man Thing, to be quite honest, because it's, you know, it's black and white and everything. And you're just like, that's what it looks like. Is that what they're going for? I didn't hear anything about this.
And I knew the moment I saw that proboscis move.
And
yeah, me too.
I love the red eyes. I thought that was great. I was shocked. I was shocked at how well it was pulled off, and it was just like, oh, look at that. And it's in full bright light and everything, too, so it's not like you're cheating.
Beautiful. It. Looked absolutely beautiful, but I was the whole time I'm like, man, but it's not in color, so I don't want to sing too many praises, but it looked beautiful, and all I could think was it looks so much better to me than the Disney Online, or not Disney, the DC Online Swamp Thing looked.
Mm-hmm.
You guys remember that show?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it does. It
looks starring as the Swamp Thing or whatever.
It looks a lot better, but they also make the really smart choice at the beginning with that character, where he's in shadow and he's also hidden by bushes, and like that's the way you do it with that character. And,
but then at the end, we get a pretty good glimpse of him with like the shrooms, the toadstools growing mm-hmm. on his shoulders.
Yeah, I like that.
Mm-hmm. Oh man, it just looks so good at that like campsite the morning after, basically. And I was just so impressed with how good he looked and how Disney has come a long way since that movie they made that we watched down in Australia or whatever it was called, Man Thing.
It was like, yeah, I was so shocked at how decent looked and everything. And all I could think of is just like, the elements are here now. All we got to do is get a little Howard the Duck and some Man Thing. I'm like, they're there now. They're all in season, yeah, as it were.
Nexus. And they really, the direction they're going with Kang and the multiverse. I mean, I'm surprised Swamp Thing Man Thing wasn't already in the MCU, because he's the nexus of all realities. And I don't even know how, you know, as a Marvel fan, I don't know how they didn't try to bring him in before the Doctor Strange movie.
Now I will say this. Here's a quick thing that I did understand is that they asked Michael Giacchino, A, is this canon? And the answer to that is yes. And B, where in the Marvel universe does this take place? And he will not say that. But it is canon. This show goes throughout all the Marvel stuff. This isn't just like a what if comic. This is going everywhere, but we're not sure exactly when in said timeline that this.
We have a bit of a time frame, though. We do have a time frame on this.
Okay.
Because they pull the trickaroo on you that it takes place, you know, basically pre-World War II. Mm-hmm. But at the end, when they're out of the place and they're just kind of camping by the side of the road there, and it goes into color, they're talking about what they're going to get to eat, and they say sushi. So that at least puts you into the 1980s.
Yeah, that's because I did think that was an odd line. I was just like, would that be what they said? Okay, that makes sense.
I think we're going to find out that it was probably. I think that Feige's probably clever, and it's taken place in 2001, which is when Elsa Bloodstone made her first appearance in Marvel.
Hmm.
That's how I'm rolling my dice.
Huh.
I want to talk about
that one Monster Hunter was wearing I Love Friends fourth season on his t-shirt during that one scene.
But just four season though.
Just the fourth season.
Harriet Harris, I want to talk about, because like this woman has been in like everything that you've ever seen in your entire life, and she's yes. so great in all, like whatever she shows up in, I am so happy to see her.
Yeah, she's a killer, man.
Obviously, like to me, her greatest recurring role ever is on Frasier as BB, and she's just every time it was a BB episode, you weren't like, oh no, here comes another one of these. It was just like, she is so good.
Who's BB?
Oh, you don't remember the what was her exact role in Frasier? I think she was.
When you say BB, I'm thinking BB Newirth, who was Lilith in regards to Frasier. So my brain is like fried.
So I forget.
I always think of her. You look that up. I always think of her as the lady from Adam's Family, the second one.
Adam's Family Values.
Yes.
Yeah, she's.
Actually recognize her from anything.
Oh yeah, she was in The One. We reviewed that not too long ago.
Yeah, it's true. She is.
I was missing on that one, I think.
Yes, you were. You were missing on that. Yeah. You know, it's she's I mean, you know, Adam and I are just suckers for character actors, you know, where, you know, like, oh my god, they're stealing the scene. Like I do that all the time with character actors. Like this weekend I also watched Confess Fletch, being a huge book fan. And Confess Fletch does the very smart thing where they take the world's greatest character actors and put them in the movie. And just scene after scene after scene of John Hamm, who is a great actor, just getting the scene completely stolen from him, from whomever you wish. anyway, that is what this lady does, man. And she does it just over and over again.
BB Glazer. I keep saying Mueller because it's the
agent. I looked it up.
Yeah,
too.
She was the agent. And she was always like, don't worry, darling, I've got the best thing for you. And she was always just like, if there was anybody that could, like, you know, twist Frasier up, it was her. And she was so good and just so annoying that, like, oh, you loved it when she showed up. And I loved it when she showed up here because I was just like, oh, she's going to be
She's definitely good here as the wicked stepmom.
Yeah, and like with I love the makeup and being like when he transforms and everything and smashes her over towards the cage and everything, which by the way, that cage is also kind of reminiscent of the cage that they put Stanley Kubrick in 2001. When they were shooting 2001 A Space Odyssey, there's that scene that you see where the lions and all the other stuff are kind of laying out in the area there. Well, yeah. That was all done on a soundstage, and everyone was pretty much open except for Kubrick. they put him in this cage that looks somewhat similar to the cage that they use here. And it's funny. It's like everyone was just like, should we be in this cage? Because these wild animals are here. But it was just like only Stanley was in the cage.
So awesome. Oh, my God. I want to do that.
Everybody was out there standing behind the cameras, just like white knuckling it, hoping that these creatures from the Serengeti will not come alive and rip everyone's face off. Whereas Stanley, still very scared, but is the only person behind bars.
It's kind of like when you get an X-ray. And like they put the thing a quarter of an inch from your chest, and they jump behind this wall. They bring in
everything's with them fine. Window, don't worry.
They got a lead apron and everything. They're pushing a button from way back, and everybody ducks.
Why did you just say Santa Maria before you turn the button on?
Woo! Just do a little sign of the cross, and you're good to go.
So, what about Gael Garcia Bernal?
I think that he is doing what he's supposed to be doing in the show. Because they're not asking him to do much. No. I mean, he basically just has to be the audience surrogate for half of it. And then, you know, the last 10 minutes, he's a werewolf.
Yeah.
But like, I think that he does just fine.
He feels like kind of a big name for this role. Is that fair to say?
Sure.
I mean, because he's got a recognizable name, right?
Yeah.
Certainly internationally.
Yeah, I know who he is.
Yeah, and I kind of expected, well, it's just a special. I mean, who knows? Maybe there'll be more stuff for him to do in the future or something. But I was watching, I just kind of thought about how little it seemed was asked of him for this.
Well, think about this.
Yeah, I mean, he's just a surrogate. And that's fine. I thought he did a good job doing that. You know, a lot of the time people are so blank nothingness that you end up hating them, but he isn't that, you know, like there's a genteel nature to him, at least in this role that really shines through.
And they specifically, before they had cast him, they were looking specifically for a Latino actor to cast in this role. And in 2020, they had a new Werewolf by Night in the comics rather than Jack Russell. They had a new character named Jake Gomez. So I like it that I think they're sort of combining the two characters together a little bit, you know, they're sort of keeping the Latin heritage, but then keeping the name Jack Russell, which was originally Russoff when they were from Transylvania.
Oh, okay.
I think it was just kind of cool. I kind of want to see what sort of backstory this Jack Russell has for us. You know, like I'm looking forward to finding out more about this character in the future, which I think is a good way for a special presentation to leave you feeling, isn't it?
Oh, well, I think that probably what we're going to get is we're going to get, because this thing was so successful to me and to other like-minded nerds, I think that we're going to get a lot more of these one-offs, and I am totally down with that full time. Like, yes, give me this.
It would be kind of cool if it was a super scary season tradition that we just got a special from Marvel Horror every October.
Well, I think what they're gunning for here, it just feels this way to me. I don't have insider information, is that you're going to get your Halloween episode, you're going to get your Christmas episode. I think that that's what's going to continue to happen.
Because they've been
Guardians of the Galaxy Christmas special this year. That's this year, right?
I don't know.
And maybe next year, maybe 2023. Right. Who knows, man? But Yeah, I to me, I think that this is the way that you can kind of do these things and have this be, you know, if you're not willing to put down a full season of television and stuff, you know, Loki, She-Hulk style, whatever, you know, throw a wonder out there with something like this. And if it doesn't hit, then you haven't, you know, haven't spit on everybody and just gone like, well, we made you watch 80 hours of that garbage. No,
it's also... You know what it also is? It's the way that they introduced new comic book characters in the 60s and in the 30s, where it's like, look, we don't know if this is going to work or not. So we have this thing called Amazing Fantasy, and we're just going to throw this one character in there and see how it works.
Absolutely.
And if Man-Thing kicks off, and then all of a sudden people, and I'm telling you, I because first of all, it's so good looking and so well done and everything that I'm telling people are going to be like, oh, shoot, when you getting some more Man-Thing in there? Because that's going to be the thing that people take away from this, I believe 100%.
Yeah. I think that's the whole point. I mean, when you measure and weigh the fandom, comic book history, like the Q value of all the different characters, the debut of Man-Thing here is just... Is absolutely mon. Yeah, Ted Salas. I mean, he's always been
named. Oh, Theodore, I feel nasty.
But yeah, this is that's the bomb that was dropped here. That is the landmark that was pulled off here.
Yeah, it was a bloody miracle because I hate Man-Thing. I hate that character so much. Even when he shows up in like a Punisher style, like cameo in another comic book, I'm like, well, okay.
I love they portrayed, though, his touch burns to all evil or something like that. Like his touch burns all who are evil, I think is the way that his power is described in the comics. I love the way it's depicted as he just puts his hands on these people and they burn. Like they just burn.
Yeah, that's
like
very
way
cool.
Even more gruesome than what Ghost Rider's pulled off so far.
Yeah, I think it's more successful. And I like the Ghost Rider from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, that was cool. I wish we could explore something like that more. And this could be a place for things like that to happen.
But I feel like they want to go back. Well, I don't say go back, but I think that they, I don't know, where am I getting this? I have no idea, but I feel like they want to give us a Johnny Blaze.
Oh, man, that is not the way to go, man. I much prefer the Robbie version or you have the guy on the horse.
Well, yeah, that's cool too.
Oh, I think if you put a guy on a horse in the 21st century, people don't like horses. I'm gonna be I know how 23-year-olds think. They'd be like, screw horses, man. I ain't watching this crap. I don't know why.
There's also Danny Ketch, which came in between them. So
yeah,
you could go
That's the first Ghost Rider I read because that's the one from the 90s. Yeah, so
yeah, of course that's the first. You know, it's like Kyle Rayner is our Green Lantern. We are from a weird time.
Yes,
Barry Allen is our Flash.
I know
not Barry Allen, but what's his
name? Wally West.
Yeah, he's our Flash. But anyway,
I read way more Wally West comics than I ever did Barry comics.
Yeah, we all did.
He won the lottery.
Because, I mean, Barry was gone for literally 30 years or at least 25.
At least.
But anyway, back to the Ghost Rider thing. I mean, Ghost Rider and Man-Thing would be so great, like just tearing through a bunch of evil people at once. I mean,
now, does Man-Thing ride in the sidecar? How does that work?
but I mean, just imagine we got something on par of like 50 or 60 evil doers out there to do some evil. And then these two guys just burning them up like by the bunches. Of course, they got to be some evil robots or aliens or something because they're going to burn them alive. But my son did comment this was the goriest Disney MCU thing he's ever seen. That might be part of the
black
and white. I was about to say black and white probably didn't probably help that along a little bit, I'd say.
Yeah,
because I mean they are just straight up killing regular old humans. They're burning burning them alive too.
But cutting off limbs.
I think that Danny Ketch would be very tempting because he's kind of the Scott Lang of Ghost Riders.
Yeah.
So he would be very tempting there because Nicolas Cage is a hard face to get out of your mind. And then with Danny, they got to deal with like how much Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. do we really want to get into?
As is my understanding, you guys correct me if I'm incorrect on this, but I'm to understand that like none of that's canon anymore. Am I wrong? Or am I making that up?
Well, I think that you can say none of it's canon, but I don't know that they're looking to start a fight by recasting Robbie Reyes. And I also don't think they want to bring in the same Robbie Reyes. Like I could be wrong.
Oh, I thought the actor's name was Robbie Reyes for half a second. And I'm just like, I'm like, hold on now. How are they going to replace the man with another? I'm like, what are the odds of that? You don't replace George Clooney with another George Clooney very often.
You do. You just don't do it successfully.
That's true. It's like, here's George Clooney. He's from Iowa.
His name's actually George C. Looney, but he's the closest we could find.
It all smashes together when you put it on the marquee. It's fine.
But I feel like they really need a Ghost Rider soon now that they've got Man-Thing and Werewolf by Night and Moon Knight. I mean, they're working on a pretty good roster for Midnight Suns. The thing is, I don't know when Blade's due out. It's kind of hard to have a Midnight Suns without Blade.
Well, now, also, good old Blade's been being pushed back, unfortunately, it looks like, because things are just not going well. I think the director, whoever they had, I forget off the top of my head, production
is slow. I wish Blade would come out this month and they push back Black Adam, but that's a conversation.
is there anybody like really juiced to see that movie? I don't know anybody who's like, yes.
All I know is it better be super scary because it's screwed up our super scary season.
Man,
it's going to be scary how good The Rock is in that movie. Well, I mean,
Spock is like a devil looking dude. Devil dudes are super scary.
Devil dude, we got a superhero that's trademarked. No one can copyright that. That's
Devil
ours.
Dude, put it down.
Super scary devil dude, full name. We used to call him SS Devil Dude, and people are like, no, dude, you need to workshop
that's no good. The audiences are going not so much. Well, before we get to our final review here and everything, we have to ask ourselves one very important question: is how this Marvel special presentation connects one-to-one with Sylvester Stallone.
Why, thank you, Adam. I have a prepared statement.
Oh.
Cary Jones is the Stallone connection this week. He plays Ted, which is all I will ever call Man-Thing from this point forward. And Mr. Stallone, Cary Jones has the sort of career every tall, nerdy nerd like myself dreams of. He's in a Star Wars as Kersantan. He's been a Predator in the third best Predator movie ever made. It's Predators. He's in a creep show. He even played the alpha werewolf on the TV show Teen Wolf, which is a show I've never seen, because how can you make a Teen Wolf without the acting prowess of Mark Hilton as Chubby?
Thank you.
But here's the secret to Cary Jones' success, Mr. Stallone. Acting isn't even his day job. These days, he's the special effects supervisor for Werewolf by Night and The Walking Dead. And Watchmen. Now that's how you live your life. When you've become successful at both sides, you can turn down gigs that sound like really bad ideas. Like, for instance, do you think Eugene Levy wanted to star in American Pie, The Naked Mile? Of course not. But he didn't have many options, and they were just offering him too much money, so he had to take it. And that's the beauty of Cary Jones's career. He can pretty much say no to anything because he's successful with both sides of his life, makeup artist and as an actor. When he was still relatively new to the business, he was a key technician on Spy Kids 3D Game Over, which also starred you as the toy maker. And as someone who has seen that movie roughly, 700 times, because my kids were in the sweet spot age-wise for that movie, let me tell you, you are the best part of it. But getting back to Cary Jones, what does a key technician do on movies? I don't know. But looking at context clues, I'm going to say it's something to do with the special effects department. And thankfully, Werewolf by Night hired him to work on their weird little movie because he's this week's Stallone connection. Now, this is episode 2 of our countdown to contact with you or your people. And I'm interested in hearing what you think of our dumb show and this dumb segment in particular. I hope to hear from you soon. Your pal, Sweet Shaunzy from the internet.
Mark Holton, who played Chubby, still kicking around.
Yeah.
And was in it.
Recently have a conversation where your mom asked you why you weren't as famous as Mark Holton?
No, that was a different person. I look better than Mark Holton, you SOB.
Is it Holton?
Holton. Okay. H-O-L-T-O-N. He was in Leprechaun Returns in 2018. So
I spelled it wrong.
Your boy's still working on the Leprechaun. I like it. I like it. Well, here at Hero Movie Podcast, we have our own special patented Robin rating system. Bruce, where does Werewolf by Night fall in the Robin rating system for you?
It's good, solid fun. This is going to be a regular watch for Super Scary Season every year from now on, or at least as long as I have access to it. You know, nice Halloween regular viewing. I kind of wouldn't mind going out in the backyard, building a bonfire, and watching on the old inflatable projector thing out back. So I'm going to give it to Tim Drake. It's good, solid fun. Not exactly perfect, but it's everything it needs to be. Tim Drake.
Sean?
Oh, man, for me, this is a Dick Grayson. I think that they, maybe I just watched it at the perfect time, you know, like on a Saturday, on a sleepy Saturday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah. It was perfect. And so it's the thing that Marvel doesn't do very often, which is it takes chances. It has absolute directorial ideas in it. And it has so much fun with what it is that it kind of emanates through the screen as you're watching it. So for me, it's a Dick Grayson, man. I love this thing.
Going to be a strong Tim Drake for me. Really enjoyed it. I guess the only little tiny thing, and I understand it, I get it, but the budget on this was low enough to where, like, we kind of really didn't go anywhere, and it felt like it was very just kind of not bottle episode per se, but close enough to where we're in this one location. I just feel like we could have gone a little bit more, a little bit.
Adam would like crazy to see the werewolf jump out of a plane.
Yeah. He
wants to see him lead like a dancing flash mob at the local mall.
With double Uzis in each hand, you know, just falling down from the helicopter. Like, this is just what I want. Man Thing driving the helicopter.
Nathan's hot dog eating contest in human form.
We got to wait till the human form. You're not going to be cheating over here. That's no good. But yeah, listen, I liked it. I liked it a lot. And I especially like where it opens up things for the future of Marvel to go and stuff like that. And I like that it's all within canon and stuff. So, you know, they don't have to go, oh, wait, what, that Man Thing, that was only a one-off. You can't expect us to do that. No, we do expect you to do it, and we expect you to do it well, so get on top of it. So that will do it for this episode of HMP, everybody. We're going to talk about what we'll be doing next week in just a moment. In the meantime, Bruce, where can we find more of your work on the internet?
Go check out my YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/BruceLeslie. You're going to find I got a nice little 4-minute video welcoming everyone to Super Scary Season and talking about my plans for the YouTube channel over the next 3 weeks to celebrate Super Scary Season. And I got a few super scary surprises worked into my regular videos that'll be coming out in the next 3 weeks.
I'm scared just thinking about it. Sean?
We have got a Star Wars show called Andor 30 Questions. And each week we ask 30 questions of the newest, latest episode of Andor. And unlike a lot of Star Wars properties recently, we seem to be okay. We all three of us seem to be okay with this show. So please check that out. It's funsies, guys. Just check it out.
We're not burning it in effigy yet. Yet. Watch yourself, Disney. So do check out all of that. And next week, we're going to be talking Dr. Giggles with our friends over at the All-American Spook Show podcast. And we're going to be talking with them and do a little bit of a different type of show. So we'll be checking out Dr. Giggles and getting that's dentistry in that thing, isn't it? I'm scared of that.
Oh, yeah. I think he's a dentist.
I'm not a super fan of that. I got to get a lot of dental work done, so I'm already just like on pins and needles with this one. But we'll talk about all of that fun stuff next week. And, of course, as always, remember, you can support the show over at patreon.com/HMP. Pre-show, post-show, Dinger Zone, get yourself a nickname, all that good stuff. That'll do it, everybody. Join us next week when we're talking Dr. Giggles. For Sweet Sean Kovacs from the Internet, Bruce Leslie, I'm Adam Porters. Stay super, everybody.
Bye, Marty. Freaks come out at night. 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 Discos don't open till after dark, and it ain't till 12 till the party really starts. And I always had to be home by 10, right before the fun was about to begin. Crowds of people lined up inside and out, just for one reason, to rock the house. But in the daytime, the streets were clear. You couldn't find a good freak anywhere, cause the freaks come out at night. The freaks come out at night. The freaks come out at night. Freaks come out. The freaks come out at night. 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 Freaks come out. The freaks come out at night. Now when freaks get dressed to go out at night, they like to wear leather jackets, chains and spikes. They wear rips and zippers all in their shirts.
real tight pants and fresh mini skirts. All kinds of colors running through their hair, and you can just about spot a freak anywhere. But then again, you could know someone all their life and might not know they're a freak unless you see them at night. Cause
freaks come out at night. Freaks come out at night. Freaks come out at night.
Freaks come out.
Freaks come out at night.
Freaks come out.
Freaks come out at night. Freaks come out at night.
Jumping, the place is packed, and when the crowd's like this, I'm ready to rap. But before I could buzz around on the mic, freaks are all over me like white on rice. Freaks come in all shapes, sizes, and colors, but what I like about them most is that they're real good lovers. They do it in the park, they do it in the dark, but most freaks are known for breaking hearts. You can never tell what a freak is thinking of, and you may never catch a freak without at least one glove. They don't walk, when they step, they strut. Nine times out of ten, they drive you nuts. So take my advice, you don't stand a chance. Freaks are so bad, they got their own dance. So if you wanna live a nice, quiet life, do yourself a favor, don't come out at night. Cause
freaks come out at night.